Now, I don't know if you want me to go into the international and the other step, like Ambassador Hori said. Yes, so I'll go quickly, try to go quickly. I think that a key issue, as we were talking about psychology, about other issues, is one issue that Ambassador mentioned, which is lifestyle, which is what in Rio in 1992 we called unsustainable patterns of consumption. No? I think that from 1992 to today, we advanced a lot in dealing with unsustainable patterns of production, but we advanced very little in unsustainable patterns of consumption. And this is absolutely key, because every one of us, every day, makes thousands of consumption choices. We have an enormous influence on the emissions of our country, on the impact of the planet. And unfortunately, we have models of middle class that are extremely unsustainable. And what do we want? When we're talking about international cooperation for development, for sustainable development, what do we want? We are combating poverty, which is something that fortunately we have been doing quite successfully in Brazil. But once you combat poverty, you transform this person ideally in a middle class person. So you are creating consumers, which is very good for the economy, because Brazil, fortunately, China, India, all these countries have been living through this crisis by this introduction of hundreds of millions of people in the market. This is the best news in recent years, not only because people are living poverty, but because you are creating scale for new technologies. We don't have anymore that model that we thought, let's develop something for the middle class of Europe or United States and Japan, and let's adapt it for the other ones. No. Now we have such an amazing scale that is appearing, literally billions of people, that for countries like Japan, for Germany, for the United States, it's an amazing opportunity to do more than simply adapt technologies that were developed for some tens of millions of people. We're talking about billions of people. So we have here an amazing opportunity. But if we don't change the middle class model that we all learn on TV in developing countries, which is unfortunately very attractive, everybody leaves poverty and wants to have three cars, a house in the suburbs, et cetera, which we know is impossible. So, the other impossible thing that we have to do in Rio is that you cannot continue to have Americans or Germans, nothing against any of them, but middle class in rich countries, behaving in a way and thinking that the others cannot behave like them. This is not possible. You cannot create two classes of middle classes. So you have to change the consumption patterns of the middle class. We want to arrive in 2050 with 9 billion middle class. That's what we're doing. We are combating poverty. By combating poverty, you're not going to have people that just eat. They are people that are going to do more than eat. So we have to face that in a very straightforward way. Japan is a very good example in many areas. As you mentioned here, sustainable city development. Your middle class is infinitely less unsustainable than other middle class. But I think that the technology challenge of this introduction of billions of people in the middle class is something that Japan will make maybe its biggest contribution to sustainability. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So in Brazil, there are many the challenges being faced that you need to have the interaction coordination amongst the different agencies and ministries, and there are different perspectives in the Amazon and the Sao Paulo. And I believe these differences do exist in the other countries and in the other regions of the world as well, especially the middle class, the lifestyle issue. This is not just for industrialized countries, but also in the newly emerging economies as well. There are increasing number of people joining the middle class. And when the consumption patterns becomes very similar to the industrialized countries, then what would happen? I believe the serious question has been raised. Thank you very much for raising these important issues. Last but not least, Dr. Torgersen, please.
Thank you very much, I'm delighted to be here. This issue brought me to Japan for the first time in 97 to Kyoto, and that's where I met Hamanaka-san for the first time, and so it's a great pleasure to be here. The fact that I'm an international civil servant working for the Climate Change Secretariat means that I would give you a more of an international flavor that rather than focusing on any one country. And I think it would be actually helpful to ask the question, what is the international community doing now, between now and 2020? There was this focus in the first panel on the future framework, and that's a hugely important question. The problem that is being solved is going to be the same now and after 2020. And therefore, there is a continuum between progress, success, and challenges now, and the challenges that will be faced beyond 2020. And I think it's one thing that we need to remind ourselves is that the Climate Convention is a sustainable development convention. It's not an environmental treaty. That is a very fundamental issue and it cannot be taken out of the equation. Therefore, the whole issue of development, resilience, is very core to the Climate Convention. It's not extraneous to the Climate Convention. So I think that is why Rio is the fact that governments are reconvening, and not only governments, but the global community is reconvening in Rio this year, should give additional energy to international cooperation, because that's what this is really all about. But I would ask two questions, basically. Where is the international community going, and how is it going there? Because this is a purposeful undertaking. And first on where we are going, the goal has been made quite clear, to keep warming within safe levels. It's difficult to give a very precise number to what is safe, but we know very clearly what is unsafe. And for that reason, the governments have agreed that at least initially to say that the warming needs to be kept within below 2 degrees. But there's an active process to look at the advocacy of that. And it's quite clear that the science is suggesting that you would need to go to levels, stabilize warming at lower levels than that. And 1.5 degrees has been mentioned as a possible goalpost. So there is a direction. So the question is, where do you need to be in 2020 to keep that direction still on the table? And that question can be approached with some certainty, but nothing in this whole question is absolute. And I think it is helpful to think about this in terms of absolute quantities. And basically, to keep a 50% chance of staying below 2 degrees, it suggested that global emissions could only be 44 gigatons by 2020. I'm mentioning this here just to kind of remind ourselves that development is going to be constrained. But that doesn't mean that you cannot provide goods and services. Because one thing that is key, and you understand this very well in this country, what you are interested in is the benefit of heat and light and transport. You're not interested in emissions. You don't want emissions, you want the services. And therefore, the whole question here is about efficiency. It's all about getting more for each ton emitted. And therefore, it's a very exciting undertaking. But it's very much about then technology, but it's also clearly about policy. And that policy is not just national. It's international. If each country had its own atmosphere, then it would be a lot simpler. The reality is that that's not the way this planet is constructed. And therefore, I just wanted to kind of put out some of those basic principles initially. And then this has led to kind of giving the overall direction. So how are governments moving towards that direction? And what is the character of that effort now, between now and 2020? And Alf put out a question, to what extent is it multilateral? To what extent is it confrontational? How much of it is cooperative? And basically, the current collaborative arrangement is very much based on cooperation and partnership. And this emerged, one of the photos that was shown here at the beginning was from Bali. And that was the basic agreement that was reached already in Bali in 2007, was that all governments will participate in this effort. This will be a collective effort, but there will be different contributions. And those contributions will be very much reflecting national realities. But one thing that is very core to this is that there will be in that the whole concept of enabling support. And I would want to spend a few moments on this, because we've heard first now a little bit about what has been termed the fast start finance, which is part of this effort to mobilize enabling finance. But that has been taken out now to a more precise level, again, in terms of a goal. And you've heard about this goal of raising, by 2020, $100 billion annually for supporting developing countries, both on adaptation and mitigation. But this effort to mobilize support is very much connected to the whole question of action. And so it's not support in isolation, it's support in connected to action. And that's where the partnership aspect comes in, I think. And there was a debate in this process initially, what comes first? It was kind of a chicken and egg question. What comes first, support or action? And what was really the only way through that was to say they will move together. And so this mobilization is, it is a collective effort and a collective undertaking. The support is both in terms of finance, technology, and capacity building. And that is just illustrates the need, where the constraints are. The constraints are in technology, they are in finance, and also in capacity, both institutional capacity and other aspects of capacity. And what I could end by pointing out is how we as Secretariat are supporting governments in making these things happen. And the most important, in most people's minds, delivery out of Durban was to agree to the governing instrument for the Green Climate Fund. And this construction of this major undertaking is already underway. Our Secretariat and that of the Global Environment Facility was asked to put in place an interim secretariat. This we have done. We are now waiting for agreements from governments who they will nominate to provide guidance to this fund in its governing board, and the first meeting of the board of the Green Climate Fund is slated to happen at the end of April. And what I wanted to end by underlining here is that at the end of the day, the question will be about governance. And for that reason, Durban put a lot of emphasis on reporting, accountability, and the effort to look at what everybody else is doing. Because that is something that is going to be essential to allow national policies to go forward, is to actually know what is happening somewhere else. And by the way, on the private sector, what we are hearing at the international level from the private sector is that they are pushing governments to act. And yes, they are concerned about the cost, but they are more concerned about the uncertainty on cost than the cost itself. And therefore, governments are really being pushed by the private sector to clarify what is expected and how much emissions are going to be acceptable. Thank you.